हेलो गाइस, नमस्ते मित्रों। तो कैसे हो आप लोग? पेट्रो ज्ञान पेट्रो सीरीज में आपका स्वागत है। आज का टॉपिक है सकर रोड पंप सिस्टम। सो लेट स्टार्ट। सकर रोड पंप सिस्टम एंड इट्स मॉनिटरिंग एंड ट्रबल शूटिंग। सो व्हाट इज रेसिप्रोकेटिंग रॉड सिस्टम? रेसिप्रोकेटिंग रॉड सिस्टम इज अ आर्टिफिशियल लिफ्ट सिस्टम इन विच वी आर यूजिंग अ सर्फेस यूनिट टू इम्पार्ट अ रेसिप्रोकेटिंग मोशन टू द डाउनहोल एंड देयर इज अ पॉजिटिव डिस्प्लेसमेंट पंप एट द डाउन होल एंड नियर टू द फॉर्मेशन जोन। सो या दिस इज द बेसिकली व्हाट रेसिप्रोकेटिंग रॉड सिस्टम इज। नाउ दिस सकर रॉड पंप इज ऑल्सो नोन एज बीम पंप, सकर रॉड पंपिंग, रॉड पंपिंग, पंप जैक, नोडिंग डोंकी, पंपिंग यूनिट, हॉर्स हेड पंप। सो दिस आर द बेसिकली डिफरेंट नेम्स ऑफ सकर रॉड। सो हियर इज द सर्फेस यूनिट ऑफ द सकर रॉड पंप। So starting from well head, then stuffing box, flow line, poly stored, carrier bar, hanger, your horse head, your walking beam, this is your central bearing, this is your equalizing bearing, then center bearing is on the stuffing, your Samson post, then this is your pitman arm, then this is your crank, this is your counterbalance, this is your gear reducer. This is your brake and this is the whip belt from which we give a rotational motion to gear reducer from your prime mover, and this is the brake lever. So this is the entire surface unit of the sucker rod pump. In market, basically six type of surface units of sucker rod pump are there, starting with conventional sucker rod pump. In some conventional sucker rod pump, there are two pumps. One is beam balance and one is crank balance. So here counterweight is balanced on beam, and in your crank balance conventional sucker rod pump, your counterweight is balanced on your crankshaft. This is Lufkin mark II sucker rod pump, where your equalizing bearing is at the near to the horse head, and your central bearing is at the end of your beam. And this is the air balance unit, where your counterweight is not there. But to give a counter force, there is a piston and cylinder piston type system is there, where compressed air give a counter action. Now torque master or reverse mark. So basically to give a more torque, this torque master sucker rod pump is used, where the rotation of your crank or and counterweight is opposite to the your conventional sucker rod pump. This is your low profile, where your there is if there is a restriction of area, then you can use this low profile sucker rod pump. Now sucker rod pumping system, starting from prime mover. So prime mover will generate a rotational motion, which is transferred to the gear reducer by V belt, and gear reducer transfer this rotational motion to the crank, and counterweight will give a counterbalance effect and equalizing the torque in upstroke and downstroke, and this rotationary motion is converted to the linear motion to the walking beam. Now walking beam will transfer the motion to polish rod, then polish rod will transfer to the sucker rods, and these sucker rods will transfer a reciprocating motion to the subsurface sucker rod pump, and it will enhance the oil production. Now this is the basically valid components for the sucker rod pump. So same up to the your tubing hanger, same, there is a vent line which is connected to your flow line. So above your tubing hanger there is a stripper, work as a BOP for the sucker rod system, and there is a pumping tee which is connected to flow line. Then stuffing box basically clean the polished rod in upstroke and downstroke motion. There is a lubricator, then polished rod, carrier bar, polished rod clamp which connect the polished rod to the wire hanger, and there is a rod coupling is also there. So this is the basically valid component for the rod pump accessories. So rod pump accessories, rod guides and scraper, funny rod, polished rod and clamp,
XOR complete, shrinker bar, stuffing box, rod rotator, polystrode rod lubricator, and BOP. So BOP is same as stripper. Starting with stuffing box. So basically stuffing box will seal the polystrode and lead the fluid being produced through flow line, and this poking packing will provide a seal. And if this seal is loose, then they may leak, and if this seal is tight, then they may produce a friction. Now sucker rod sockets and slim hole couplings. So this slim hole couplings are basically used to connect your polystrode and your sucker rods. Now roller guide and scraper. So these are the scraper, which are basically scraper are used to scrape your asphalt and wax deposition in the tubing. And this is your roller guide. This roller guide will basically guide the your sucker rods in the high deviation means in high deviated wells. Rod rotator. So this rod rotator will rotate the rod string in clockwise direction, which remove the same function as scraper. It will help scraper to remove paraffins and wax in the tubing. Your naming or designation of your beam pumping or sucker rod surface unit. So it's basically divided into 5 parts. First is your unit type. Second is your gear reducer maximum torque in 1000 lbf. Third one is number of gear reductions. So this is torque. This maximum torque is for gear reducer. And here third one is your number of gear reductions. Fourth one is structural capacity in 100 lbf. And your fifth one is maximum stroke length in inches. So in your first one, types of your beam pumping, where X is denoted the first position, B is your B type is your conventional beam balance, C type is your conventional crank balance, A is your air balance, M is your Mark II, Lupkin Mark II, and TM means your torque master type of surface unit. Components of subsurface pump. So your sucker rod is extended up to the downhole pump, and your sucker rod is connected with the plunger, and this plunger basically reciprocate in the barrel, and plunger having a traveling valve at the end, and this barrel having a standing valve at the end. So these are all the components of the subsurface pump. Now type of subsurface pumps. So basically two types of subsurface pump are there. One is insert rod type of subsurface pump, and second one is tubing pump. So in insert rod pump, we are inserting this subsurface pump into the tubing by the sucker rods. And tubing pump is basically we are lower at the time of lowering of tubing, only we are lowered the subsurface pump. So in insert type of rod pump, there are the three subsurface pump are there. One is stationary barrel top hold down, second one is stationary barrel bottom hold down, and third one is a traveling barrel. Basically two type of subsurface sucker rod pumps, your tubing pump and insert pump. So tubing pump is basically barrel assembly of this type of pump is screwed onto the tubing only, and it is an integrated part of tubing only. And your insert pump is completely attached to the sucker rods, and it inserted with the help of sucker rod only into the tubing. And in tubing type of sucker rod subsurface sucker rod pumps, there is one advantage that there is a larger bore area than the insert pump. So here we can produce a greater volume in any given tubing diameter. And in insert pump, the advantage is that as a complete unit, pump may be pull out with the sucker rod pump. We not to have pull out all the tubing string. So this is the basically advantage of insert pump. Now basically there are the two type of stationary insert type of sucker rod pump. One is top hold down rod pump, and second one is bottom hold down sucker rod pump. So in top hold down, basically your top seat assembly, your seat assembly is at the top of the barrel, and in your bottom hold down, your seat assembly is at the end of the barrel. So advantage of your top hold down is it's good for the sand production, means the wells that we have to produce with the sucker rod. So if there is a high sand production, we can use this top hold down type of sucker rod pumps. and second is it's also good for high GOR compared to the your bottom hold down. So there are the two advantages, but the limitation is your depth. So here your depth is constrained because there is a differential pressure act between the inside of the barrel and outside of the barrel. But in bottom hold down type of support pump, subsurface support pump, there is the same pressure which act at the outside and inside of the barrel. So here depth constraint is not there, so it can be go to the deeper depth compared to top hold down. And second is here there is no foam creation is there because here air and gas bubbles are trapped in the can be trapped in this area, but here there is no that empty space, so foamy crude can be easily produced through the your bottom hold down type of sucker rod pump. Traveling barrel rod pump. So basically traveling rod pump having a your traveling valve with the barrel only, and there is a pull tube in which there is a standing valve. So main disadvantage of traveling barrel type rod pump is depth limitation and viscous fluid. Basically high hydrostatic pressure is acting along the your standing valve means your pull tube, so it may chance of buckling of your pull tube. Basically barrel have higher thickness than your pull tube, so barrel has no problem with higher hydrostatic head, but this pull tube is having a very less thickness, so this pull tube may be buckled. So your traveling rod pump having a depth constraint. Now tubing pump. So basically tubing pump is integral part of production tubing only. It can't be removed without production tubing, so it basically need a workover rig to remove the your tubing pump. Now it permits the very large pump, so it also permit the high production. Main disadvantage is depth limitation because the large amount of rod and tubing stretch is expected due to the presence of large standing valve. Here in basically tubing pump, the standing valve is larger than the any insert type of sucker rod pump. So basically large amount of rod and tubing extension stretch extension is basically expected, so which basically limits the depth. So there is a depth constraint in tubing pump also. API designation for subsurface pump. So basically for stationary barrel and top hold down, you RHA, and here the two types of plunger. So two types of barrel are there. One is metal plunger barrel and second one is soft pipe barrel. So for metal plunger barrel, we have R, and if the wall of the barrel is heavy, then RH, and if the wall of the barrel is thin, then RW. So RHA, RWA, and RSA. RSA is for soft pack thin wall, and RHB is for the bottom hold down. Same RWB and RSW. For traveling barrel, we have RHT, RWT, and RHT same. And for tubing, we have the heavy wall only. So for the tubing pump, we have TH for the metal plunger barrel, and TP is for the soft pipe barrel. Now this is the basically nomenclature of subsurface pump. In that first two are for the tubing size, then second one is for the borehole, pump borehole size. Third one is for the pump type. Fourth one is for the barrel type. Fifth one is the location of anchor. Then the sixth one is for the type of hold down. Then this one is for barrel length, then plunger length, and extension of length. Here these are the units for the each nomenclature. Here this is the basically example for the API subsurface pump nomenclature. So here 25 means 2.5 inch of tubing, 1.75 inch of borehole pump size, then RHAM. R means rod type, H means heavy, A means top holder, and M is mechanical type. 16 is basically length of barrel, 4 is length of plunger, and 3 feet is barrel extension. So coiled lift system application. So basically virtually all type of application are there for sandy wells, gaseous wells, and high viscosity fluids. Wide range of fluid levels from the near to the surface to the sitting nipple depth. So all there is no depth constraint here. Now low to medium volume lift capacity. So it can be used for low to medium flow rate. All type of wells, including horizontal, slant, and directional, and vertical reservoir. This all type of well can be used with the sucker rod pump. Now industry standard for the land and remote application. So basically sucker rods are general artificial lift for the land. Now this is the basically table which screening criteria for the sucker rod pump. So operating depth is from 100 feet to 11,000 feet and maximum up to 16,000 feet. Operating volume is 5 to 1,500 barrel up to 5,000 barrel. Operating temperature is 100 to 350 feet. So these are the basically general criteria, selection criteria, and these are the maximum yield point up to which sucker rod can be used. Well deviation is basically 0 to 20 degree and 0 to 90 degree. So for basically horizontal well, sucker rod are not used in India. Corrosion handling is good to excellent. Gas handling is fair to good. Solid handling is also fair to good. Fluid gravity is greater than 8 API. Servicing. So basically worker rig or pulling rig can be used for the installation and removal of sucker rod pump. Prime mover type, gas or electrical. So basically we can use electric motor and rotate the prime mover, and we can use the turbine, gas turbine, for the rotation of your prime mover. Then offshore application is limited. So basically sucker rods are not used in offshore, and system efficiency is 45 to 60%. Now its advantage. So high system efficiency. So system efficiency is high of sucker rod pump. Optimization of control are available. So we can adjust the stroke length and RPM from the surface. So optimization control can be available at the surface. Economical to repair and service. Positive displacement pump, strong throwdown. So basically sucker rod pump are positive displacement, so it is having the strong throwdown capacity. Now upgraded material reduce the corrosion concern. So basically new type of sucker rods are having a corrosion free property. Flexibility, so adjust the production through the stroke length and speed. As I already discussed, that surface optimization can be done by adjusting the RPM and your stroke length. Now high salvage value for the surface and downhole equipment. Reciprocating rod system and its limitation. Basically potential for tubing and rod wear. So if your well is slant or high deviation, then rod bearing and tubing bearing is there. Then GUR, basically this is the positive displacement pump. So for high GUR, it is not give high volumetric efficiency, and most system limited to the ability of rod to handle load, and volume decrease as depth increase. So basically depth constraint is not there, but if your depth is increasing, then your barrel size will reduce, and it will definitely reduce your volume, means your flow rate. First one is ecometer survey. Basically ecometer survey enables to estimate the fluid level. In ecometer survey, basically we are sending the sonic wave, and by the identifying of peak of this sonic wave, we are identifying the fluid level. Basically this height will give us the indication of SBHP and FBHP according to fluid level. We can design the pump in running condition, and it will also help to design our SPM, desired SPM, and stroke length. Here there is a basic question which can be asked in GATE to calculate the FBHP. Here fluid level is given, perforation depth is given, and gradient of the fluid is also given. Simple FPSP calculation is there. Second one is dynagraph study. So basically dynagraph represents the health of the well. Like in human, if human has a problem of heart, then we go to the cardiograph. Same for well, it's dynograph. A dynamometer is diagnostic device which used in sucker or pump, which measures the load on the top of the road, means your polished rod load, and plots it to the position of the rod as the pumping rate moves in each stroke. The plot of polished rod load versus position of polished rod will describe as a surface card. Basically, in two type of dynamometer will there. One is subsurface dynamometer and second one is surface dynamometer. Surface dynamometer will give dynamometer card, and from that we can calculate the subsurface dynograph. Basically, in field, two type of dynamometer is are using. One is horseshoe dyno and second one is ecometer PRT dyno. Basically, a surface dynamometer card है. So let's start from the starting of the upstroke. तो जैसे ही अपस्ट्रोक का स्टार्टिंग हुआ, अपना ट्रैवलिंग वाल खुला, तो सारा लोड अपना सकर रोड पे ट्रांसफर हो गया, इसलिए लोड बढ़ रहा है. नाउ स्टैंडिंग वाल क्लोज ओपन हुआ तो उसका कुछ इफेक्ट अपने रोड लोड पे नहीं पड़ेगा. नाउ इट विल कम टू पीक पॉलिश रोड लोड. अपस्ट्रोक चालू है और जैसे ही एंड एट द एंड ऑफ अपस्ट्रोक योर स्टैंडिंग वाल विल क्लोज. तो जैसे ही डाउन स्ट्रोक स्टार्ट हुआ, लोड कम होना स्टार्ट हुआ, और जैसे ही ट्रैवलिंग वाल्व ओपन हुआ, सारा फ्लूड बैरल में चला गया, तो देन अगेन डिक्रीज ऑफ द पॉलिश लोड रोड एंड इट विल डिक्रीज अप टू द MPRL मिनिमम पॉलिश लोड रोड. नाउ डाउनस्ट्रोक विल कंटिन्यू एंड दिस इज द बेसिकली एंड ऑफ डाउनस्ट्रोक. तो दिस इज द बेसिकली साइकिल ऑफ योर अपस्ट्रोक एंड डाउनस्ट्रोक इन डायनामोमीटर कार्ड. Let me explain again. A is basically beginning of the upstroke. So plunger reverser causes the traveling valve to close. The traveling valve will close, so all the load is transferred to the sucker rod. A to B is basically the rod stretch. The plunger is stationary. Now B to C is plunger travel to the top of the upstroke and allowing the standing valve to open. Now C is the top of the upstroke, means the end of the upstroke. Now C, at the point of C, your sucker rod will beginning to the downstroke, and the plunger reverser causes the standing valve to close, and the traveling valve to open, and the load is transferred to the tubing. So load will suddenly reduce to the MPRL. Now C to D is basically rod beginning to contract and plunger is stationary. At D point, the minimum load is reached and the rod has already contracted, and now D to A, the plunger is traveled to the bottom of the downstroke, and as point A reach, it will hit the end of the downstroke. Wave equation explanation. Basically, wave equation is used to convert the surface dynagram to downward dynagram. So, what is surface dynagram? So, surface dynagram represents the total amount of work being done by the entire rod pumping system to lifting the rod and fluid and rotating the pumping unit and pushing the fluid to the production facility. So, this is basically entire work done by your surface unit. And this is the basically entire work done by your downhole pump. So how it is converted, let me explain. So basically wave equation will remove the all the work of surface dynamometer that not been generated by the downhole pump, represented by the dark area above. So ye surface dynamograph aapka describe karta hai ki surface unit ke द्वारा टोटल वर्क कितना हुआ, बट ये टोटल वर्क डाउनहोल पंप की वजह से हुआ तो ऐसा तो नहीं है, क्योंकि फ्रिक्शन आएगा, एक्सेलरेशन फैक्टर आएगा, योर काउंटर वेट इफेक्ट आएगा, तो वो सारी इफेक्ट को नेगलेक्ट करने के लिए ये वेव फंक्शन इक्वेशन लगता है, जिसकी वजह से जो डार्क एरिया है सरफेस डायनोमीटर का वो कट जाता है और जो रिमेनिंग पार्ट रहता है इट इज़ द योर डाउनहोल डायनोग्राफ। रॉड पंपिंग विजुलाइजेशन, सो बेसिकली देर आर द फोर एग्जाम्पल, फुल पंप, पंप ऑफ, गैस इंटरफ्रेंस एंड ट्यूबिंग मूवमेंट टू विजुलाइज हाउ द पंप इज वर्क। So this is basically full pump. So basically this point is starting of the upstroke. So your traveling valve is closed and your standing valve will open. Now pump will move in up direction in the hole, downhole pump. This is the basically starting of your downstroke. So load will reduce and your traveling valve will open at this position in ideal condition. And pump will move down. So basically in ideal condition your traveling valve and standing valve will, like at the starting of upstroke your traveling valve will close and at that point only your standing valve will open, and same for the starting of downstroke your traveling valve will open and your standing valve will close. This is the basically downhole pump card in ideal condition. Now in the case of gas interference, let's visualize how the gas interference dynograph will generate. So this is the basically starting point of your upstroke, where your traveling valve will close and your standing valve will open. Now pump will move in up direction. At the time of moving up direction, it will suck the oil and gas both, but due to presence of some gas and gravity segregation of your oil and gas, pump load will not directly reduce because it will not cause of opening of your traveling valve. So fluid load is on rod only. After opening of traveling valve, which is at this point, your load is transferred to the tubing. So at this point there is a sudden reduction of load due to opening of traveling valve. So यहाँ पे क्या हो रहा है कि ट्रैवलिंग वाल डाउनस्ट्रोक के स्टार्टिंग में ओपन नहीं हो रहा ड्यू टू द कंप्रेशन ऑफ गैस। अगर लिक्विड इज इनकम्प्रेसिबल, सो अगर लिक्विड रहता तो सीधा ट्रैवलिंग वाल खुल जाता, बट ड्यू टू कंप्रेशन ऑफ गैस ट्रैवलिंग वाल खुल नहीं पा रहा और इस पोजिशन पर ट्रैवलिंग वाल खुल रहा है, तो दैट्स वाई योर लोड इज रिड्यूसिंग फ्रॉम दिस पॉइंट एंड दिस इज द बेसिकली डाउन मोमेंट ऑफ योर स्ट्रोक। So this is the case of gas interference. Now pump off. So in gas interference, basically high pressure gas will enter, but in pump off condition, there is no enough liquid level. So that's why low pressure gas will enter. So same up to point. Basically at here point at C, there is not a high pressure gas, so there is no compression of gas, so traveling valve will close 100 will remain close 100%. So when your traveling valve will touch the liquid level at that point, it will open and suddenly load will reduce to the your MPRL, and this is the basically end of your downstroke. So pump off condition is already explained. Basically gas interference is high pressure gas and in pump off condition there is low pressure gas. This basically occur when your liquid level is not enough to fill your barrel. Now tubing movement. So that was the ideal condition. Basically tubing movement will happen in each condition. So it will be not the straight line. Load increase gradually due to the tubing movement. Same at time of load reduction, your load will be not reduced at sudden point, it will gradually decrease. So the rectangle is now converted into the your rhombus. We have basically dynograph showing heating up and heating down. So pump can be heat up and heat down both, hitting or bumping condition may occur in the downward situation due to the gas interference, fluid pump or unanchored tubing. So basically when your hitting is at the upstroke, so hitting up will have a spike at the end of upstroke, and if your hitting is at the downstroke, then at the end of downstroke you have a peak. So how the gas interference and your pump off condition will cause the hitting, I will explain. So this is the basically dynograph which showing the hitting down condition. So in the case of your gas interference and pump off condition, your effective stroke length will reduce. So you thought that your pump is producing the low fluid at that RPM, so you will try to increase your stroke length. So at that time it may cause the hitting up and hitting down due to the variation in your stroke length and your variation of your production due to the pump up and your gas interference case. Now this is the basically case of your bent in your barrel or your sticking pump barrel. So basically if there is a bent in your barrel, then at each stroke your plunger will have a restriction, so it will has a positive peak at the upstroke and there is a negative peak at the downstroke, because in the case of upstroke your police rod have to pull high load because of restriction, and same when you're at the case of downstroke you have a additional upthrust, so you have a additional downward negative peak at the downstroke. This is the basically case of one barrel or split barrel. So here there is a gap between your barrel and plunger, so liquid will fall in upstroke, so there is a negative peak in your upstroke. So due to falling of liquid, your load will reduce at a time. So fluid pump is basically limiting case of gas interference, where the pump intake pressure is low and incompletely filled your barrel. At that condition your fluid pump condition will happen. It's almost same like pump off. Here also the low pressure gas is there. It will cause this type of dynograph, but there is a difference between pump off and gas interference and fluid pump. I will explain. So if there is a pump off, then you have a sharp point like this. Like if you have a pump off, then you have a sharp point like this. If you have fluid pump, then this. And if you have gas interference, then you are having a graph like this. So these are the three almost similar cases. Case of one traveling valve or plunger. So if your traveling valve is one or plunger is one, at that condition you have not sudden increase of load, because as upstroke is start, your traveling valve should be closed at that moment. But here due to the one of your plunger or your traveling valve, it will not close 100%, it will remain like 80% close and 20% open, and gradually it will close. So due to that you have not sudden increase of load. Like if you have good condition of your traveling valve and plunger, you should have like graph like this. But due to your traveling valve is not close 100%, the load will not suddenly increase, it will increase gradually. So same condition, if your plunger is one, same, you have not gradually, you have not sudden increase of load, you have not sudden increase of load, you have gradual increase of load. Same at the time of opening of traveling valve, it will not open 100%, it will like close 20%. So also due to that, it's not your sudden decrease in load, it will decrease gradually. One standing valve. So if your standing valve is one, then it will prematurely pick up of your load near the down of downstroke, and if your standing valve will close, then it will also delay the release of load near the upstroke. So this will happen due to the one of standing valve. So this time dynagram will get in the case of bond standing. Here the calculation for SRP or numerical that can be asked for the SRP. Here to calculate the volumetric efficiency, Q is basically production that we are getting really at the surface. Your PD is your PD is basically your pump displacement. It is in barrel per day, and Q is also barrel into barrel per day. So to find the your pump displacement, you have to multiply your area into your stroke length. So it is basically inch per stroke into n means your rotation RPM RPM per minute, rotation per minute, and to convert it into the day, the minute to day conversion. So finally we will get the equation PD is equal to 0.1484 AP into SP into N. So it will our it will give our pump displacement. So from there we can calculate the volumetric efficiency. Here the MPRL and PPRL equation for your conventional air balance and Mark II means Lupkin Mark II type your sucker rod. So for conventional your PPRL is simple. PPRL is your peak polished rod load. So it will act when your upstroke will begin or when your traveling wall is closed 100%. So consider if your traveling wall is closed 100%, then entire fluid column will act on the road. So WF means weight of fluid plus your WR is weight of rod, and your plunger is moving in up direction, so there is a gravitational your acceleration factor which will act in addition of your acceleration factor is basically acceleration force that act on the sucker rod additionally to the weight of rods. And same for MPRL, this acceleration force will act up in upward direction, so it will in negative sign. So from the weight of rod we can subtract the acceleration factor. So here WR 1 minus alpha minus your buoyancy factor. So this buoyancy factor is can be calculated calculated from this equation. This is your density of fluid and this is the density of steel. From that for MPRL we have got this equation. Now for the air balance, so air balance same your weight of fluid plus weight of rod into 1 plus 0.7 alpha. So this acceleration factor is different in all type of sucker rods. So for air balance it's 0.7, and when we are subtracting, we are also subtracting 0.3 plus, like for addition we have 0.7 and for subtraction we have 1.3. and same for Lupkin Mark II, PPRL is basically plus 0.6, and for the MPRL we are subtracting 1.4 alpha. Alpha is basically your acceleration factor. Now well, weight of fluid can be calculated by this simple equation that you can calculate by your multiply of your area into length into density. You can get this equation. Now there is another calculation to calculate the effective stroke length. So basically effective stroke length is designs stroke length of your plunger plus plunger over travel minus your tubing stretch minus your rod stretch. So to calculate the basically rod stretch, this is the basic equation: 12F into well fluid, your weight of fluid into length into divide by area of your rod into E is your elasticity. E is basically your modulus of elasticity. So by including your weight of fluid into the rod stretch, your rod stretch means your ER, you will get this equation. this is the basically your stretching of rod. This is basically stretching of your tubing. So these two, you will get by these two equation, you get ER and ET, and EP can be calculated by this formula. EP is equal to 1.36 into 10 raised to minus 6 into L square up into SN square upon 70500, where your SN square upon 70550 is your alpha, means your acceleration factor. So your equation will simplify as this. Okay, so from that you can calculate your effective stroke length. Now, to calculate the ideal counterweight, ideal counterweight is basically PPRL plus MPRL by divided by 2. PPRL is basically weight of fluid plus weight of rod into 1 plus alpha minus buoyancy plus alpha. Here we are calculating the here we are considering the buoyancy and friction both. So minus buoyancy force plus frictional force. Same for MPRL, weight of rod 1 minus alpha minus buoyancy minus friction. Because frictional force is acting in upward direction, so at the time of downstroke it will subtract from the total load. So this will like putting these two equation into this equation, it will simplify as for counterweight, well fluid divided by weight of fluid divided by 2 in plus weight of rod 1 minus 0.127 g. G is your fluid gravity. Now basically, to calculate the unbalanced force at the time of upstroke and downstroke, so upstroke load minus your counterweight will give the unbalanced load at the time of upstroke. So it's weight of fluid divided by 2, and same at the time of your downstroke, same your unbalanced force is same. So yeah, this is all the calculation for the counterweight. To calculate the counterweight weight, here the torque on the gear reducer. So basically, torque on the gear reducer is same as the torque on the crankshaft. So it's basically your unbalanced force into the radius as a torque formula. So your peak torque at the upstroke and downstroke is formulated like this. Your PPR minus counterweight into S by 2. S is your stroke length. So basically, peak torque has a formula of this, because you are at upstroke and downstroke, your unequal force is almost same, which is well your weight of fluid by divided by 2. So the formula is like this. Here PPRL minus counterweight weight into the TF max. This is the basically torque factor, TF max divided by 0.93. So this torque factor has basically calculated given by the manufacturer, depending on your stroke length. And it's different from the for the all the unit. Like for conventional, there is a different peak torque, your torque factor for the same stroke length, and it is different for your Lufkin macro and different for the air balance. So this is basically, these tables are for the your conventional type. Now to calculate the brake horsepower, we have to calculate the hydraulic horsepower and frictional horsepower. So hydraulic horsepower has a formula of this, where Q is flow rate, G is your gravity of fluid, and L is your length of your super rods, and friction has this, that your WR is weight of rods, S is your stroke length, and N is your RPM. So from that we can calculate the brake horsepower. Now the speed of pumping unit is depend on the ratio of size of your unit motor sleeves and gearbox ratio. So basically there are the two sleeves. One sleeve is for your gearbox and one is for your motor. So motor means your engine, and one sleeve is for your unit. So basically this is the formula, like D into N is equal to NU into DU, where D is diameter of engine sleeve, NU is your speed of your unit. So basically your engine having a small diameter, so it has higher RPM, and your unit have a higher diameter sleeve, so it has low RPM. So it can be calculated by this formula. Now we come to numerical.
So here pump depth is given, your desired fluid production is given, volumetric efficiency is given, stroke length is given, the pumping speed is given, the pump diameter is given, your rod number is given. From that we can get with the rod dia and rod density, and your fluid specific gravity is also given. So you have to calculate the counterweight required and peak torque. So for calculation of counterweight, we have to calculate the PPRA and MPRA. So let me start with the weight of rod. Here density we can found out from the table, or it will be given in exam. So this is in lbf per feet. So total your pumping depth is 5900. So your total weight rod is 10700. Now your weight of fluid is calculated by this formula. Your specific gravity is 1, your length of pumping length is given, the area of plunger you can calculate out from the table. Like from that we can calculate the diameter, and from that we can calculate the area. And weight of rod is already calculated, so weight of fluid is also calculated. Now from the formula of PPRL we can find out the PPRL, but we have alpha, we need to find out the alpha. So alpha is basically SN square upon 70500. So stroke length is given 64. Your N means your RPM is also given. We have to find out the RPM. RPM is 16.5. So from that your alpha is 0.247. So from that we calculated the PPRL, and from that we also calculate the MPRL. So counterweight is basically PPRL plus MPRL by 2. So this is basically counterweight. Now calculate the peak torque. Your formula of unbalanced torque. So what is unbalanced torque? So it's the same like your PPRL minus counterweight, or your MPRL minus counterweight. So let calculate from PPRL minus counterweight into the torque factor upon 0.90. So for the given stroke length, from the table we can calculate the your torque factor. It is almost, not always, but it is almost divided by 2, stroke length divided by 2. It's come over around 32. From table we found that it's 34. Okay, so your peak torque is this 1,53,900.
Thank you friends. अगर ये वीडियो आपको अच्छा लगा है तो लाइक करिए, पैट्रिक नन चैनल को सब्सक्राइब करिए, और फॉर मोर अपडेट्स प्लीज़ फॉलो अस ऑन इंस्टा एंड फेसबुक.